balance with us, and we always will notice when we're missing a pianist or a strong song leader, the church misses out on experience of worshiping the Lord via music. So thank you, Brimmers, for using your gifts for the Lord. At this time, we're going to have a word of prayer and then dive into our time together in the Word of God. Let's bow our heads for prayer. Lord, as we come together this morning, we pray that you bless our time, that as we open your scriptures, that the words of scriptures can become true and alive and refreshing in our lives. Bless our time. We pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen. The sermon entitled this week is, What Are You Intimidated By? What Are You Intimidated By? Got stuck there. Think about something that you are intimidated by. You know, something that you're intimidated by, it's subjective. So what that means is that it depends on who you are. What's scary to you may not be scary to me. Now, each one of us have something that we're intimidated by, and I thought to myself, like, what are some areas in the world that just attracts people to it? And I quickly found out about the seven wonders of the world. Now, there are two lists. The first list is the ancient wonders of the world, where these are locations that do not exist anymore. But they at one point existed. For example, Babylon's floating garden was one of them. If you've ever heard of that, that was considered one of the seven wonders of the world. Now, in 2007, a Swiss company decided to research which seven locations can be considered seven wonders of the modern world. These are places that attract millions of people, and they recorded the responses. And one of them was the Taj Mahal. The Taj Mahal was considered one of the seven wonders of the world. It is a crowning architectural achievement that it took 20,000 workers and 16 years of building to make the Taj Mahal happen and exist. Now today, there are efforts to continue to keep the ivory marble clean from pollution. And if you've ever been to the Colosseum, you can realize that the Colosseum, if you think about the Roman Colosseum, the Roman Colosseum at one point was surrounded by marble. But because of conquest, people took the marble away. But the Taj Mahal still has its marble intact and is considered one of the seven wonders of the world. Another wonder of the world is is Petra. The city of Petra was built by the Nabataeans, who lived for more than 400 years out in the middle of the desert. They carved out of the stone different buildings, and it's really incredible to witness and see. These monuments, though, are affected by flash flooding and erosion, so this place receives millions of visitors every year to see the one of these seven wonders in the world. These places have a way to intimidate you. They're either beautiful or powerful. Something that we may take for granted is Niagara Falls. When you go to this waterfall, we may be like, everyone that comes to visit my home tends to want to go to Niagara Falls. And it's kind of like, at this point, I'm like tired of it, right? But there is something powerful about watching the water go over this end, and it's just an incredible piece of creation. But I want you all to think about something that can intimidate you, that can just shock you and just make an impact in your life. We're going to read this morning about John the Revelator. John, the man writing Revelation, and he was intimidated by something. Turn in your Bibles to Revelation chapter 1, verses 9 through 11. Revelation chapter 1, verses 9 through 11. I have the text on the screen. But if you would like to find it in your scriptures, please do so. Do not take the screen as a replacement for your Bible. Each one of us should hold the Word of God in high stature, highly esteemed. So let's continue to bring our Bibles, but we are using this technology as a tool to communicate the Word of God. Revelation chapter 1, verses 9 through 11 says, I, John, your brother and companion in the suffering and kingdom and patient endurance that are ours in Jesus, was on the island of Patmos because of the word of God and the testimony of Jesus. On the Lord's day, I was in the Spirit, and I heard behind me a loud voice like a trumpet, which said, write on a scroll what you see and send it to the seven churches, to Ephesus, Smyrna, Pergamum, Thyatira, Sardis, Philadelphia, and Laodicea. Last time we were together, we came to the conclusion that the book of Revelation is a blessing to those that listen to it and read it. The book of Revelation is not a doom and gloom book. The book of Revelation is not about finding the bunker that you need to build for yourself in case there's nuclear warfare. The book of Revelation is about the person of Jesus Christ. The book of Revelation should be a blessing to us. And I pray that as we study, you are built in confidence and in knowing that the God that loves you is the God of Revelation as well. We find, and let's break down the text. John is writing from the island of Patmos. John is incarcerated. John is not living in his bungalow, enjoying smoothies and having the best time in his retirement stage of his life. John was the youngest disciple in the midst of Jesus' disciples. Now he has outlived the majority of, I would say, the majority of the disciples, and now he is incarcerated. The text tells us that John associates himself with suffering. You know, Christians are not exempt from suffering. Sometimes we think to ourselves that, oh, peace, I'm a Christian. Oh, peace, I'm a Seventh-day Adventist. I'm not going to suffer. But John tells us that he is suffering and he identifies with those suffering. John doesn't say, because you're with God, nothing bad will happen. Actually, what John says is he associates himself with those suffering. When you go through suffering in life, you are not alone. The text tells us that it's not if we suffer, but when we will encounter suffering. But in the midst of suffering, God is still with us. Don't be discouraged, church, when you're going through a situation that you do not like. But realize that God has been with Christians through decades and centuries, that God is with you today. That you can hold fast in your belief, knowing that God is with you and that we are not just exempt from suffering, but God is with us. We need to realize that the world doesn't revolve just around you. Have you ever pouted when something doesn't go your way? Have you ever gotten annoyed at God when your life is not exactly what you expected it to be? When you made the right decision and you still have a bad outcome? We need to realize that because of sin, suffering exists. Sometimes we cause our own suffering, but sometimes we are caught in crossfire and suffer because of that. We need to realize that God understands your pain and suffering, and you can go to Him, and He will give you the strength to overcome it. In the text, John says that we have hope, so we will be patient. Think about this. Think about this. Do this mental activity in your brain. Why are you patient when you decide to be patient? Think about that. I remember... if you've ever been to a customer service desk, either at a grocery store, at some kind of store, some kind of place. People will tell you, that those that work in customer relationships, that people are not patient. I mean, who wants to be patient? The word patience comes from the word to be a patient, like at a doctor's office. When you are hurting, you are not patient. So something that came to my mind is that how can we be patient as Christians? Think about that. How can we be patient as Christians? My wife works at the ER department. When you're hurting, you do not want to be patient. And Christians are not exempt from that. So how do we, you know, go through the experience of being patient in a world that they're suffering? And what came to my mind is what I wrote up on the screen. We have hope in Jesus, so we will be patient. If you try to be patient without hope, you're going to become bitter. If you try to be patient without hope, you're going to be angry. You will be miserable if you realize that you do not have hope. But you should come to the realization, because you have hope in God in the second coming, because you have hope in Jesus, you will be patient. And that is what's happening in John's life. Because he has hope, the chains that he has on his wrists or his leg or whatever the case is, in Patmos, he has patience because he has hope. John mentions the idea of imagery of seas. Have you ever read in the Bible where it says that there will be no more sea, no more? Well, the idea of a sea, of the ocean, comes up in the book of Revelation 25 times. And when you study scripture, you start to connect the dots. Patmos is an island. An island, by definition, is surrounded by the sea, or a lake, a large body of water. And in the mind of John, he's thinking to himself, there will be one day no more sea separating John from his community. There will be no more sea that he'll be separated from his loved ones. The sea, in the mindset of John, creates a void that will one day cease to exist. The Bible tells us that one day when the Lord returns, there will be no more pain, no more suffering, and therefore no more Patmos, and no more John being incarcerated for his faith. The sea idea has a different biblical theme throughout the Old Testament. The Hebrew people were surrounded by which sea? Sea of Galilee, right? It's not necessarily what you would consider equivalent to the Pacific Ocean or the Atlantic for us here on the East Coast. But we need to understand something, that in the Hebrew mindset, the Hebrew people looked at the sea as a terrifying place to be at. Have you ever been on a cruise? Have you ever been out on the boat far from land? You realize that if you fall into the ocean, you can't probably get back to land. The sea has a destructive nature to it. The sea can be beautiful in the sense that you can experience beaches and a great time next to it. But the sea also has a moment that it can destroy lives. And that's what John is saying here, that there will one day be no more suffering, no more sea that can affect people's life and destroy it. I don't know if you guys noticed, our world church has been grieving this past 2 weeks with this helicopter here. Is called, I forgot what the nickname is, but it's a yellow helicopter here. And this yellow helicopter is used by an Adventist medical missionaries out in the Philippines to transport patients from different islands. If you knew about the Philippines, they have hundreds and hundreds of islands. And these islands are separated by water. So what do you use to go in between quickly? You can use a boat, but in this case, a helicopter. Well, 2 weeks ago, give or take 2 weeks ago, this helicopter didn't arrive at its destination with the patient and nurse on top, in the helicopter. My wife knew the pilot. They went to the same camp together as teenagers. It's really interesting because now the Filipino government and other organizations are tag teaming with Avenis to go and find the helicopter, to go and find the pilot who was an Adventist, the nurse who was an Adventist, the patient who was sick, and they still haven't found the missionaries that are missing. They haven't found the helicopter, to the best of my knowledge. So this is, again, highlighting to us, the reader, that we're not exempt from suffering. But in the midst of suffering, we have hope. And then John would say, one day there will be no more sea and all the misery that comes with it. Amen? John says that on the Lord's Day, he received this message. And some people believe that the Lord's Day is a reference to Sunday. But we find that in Scripture, specifically in Matthew 12, verse 8, Jesus refers to himself as the Lord of the Sabbath, the Lord of the Sabbath. So what we find is that this text is not referring to Sunday worship. This text is referring to the fact that the Lord is the Lord of Sabbath, that Jesus is Sabbath, and because of Jesus, we worship on Sabbath. We must always remember that because of Jesus, that is why we worship on Sabbath. Not out of fear of fear, but out of love for him and willingness to follow him. The scripture says that he was in the spirit. And the Bible says that the Bible shows different people who are in the spirit. This is a monumental experience that John is going through. He's receiving from the Lord the Holy Spirit that will help him understand what he's about to receive. And the Bible says that I heard behind me a loud voice like a trumpet. The idea of a trumpet is found from the book of Exodus. Each time a trumpet comes out in the text, we find that the Lord appears to the person who is there hearing that trumpet. The Bible is interconnected, church. If, you know, some people tell me, Pastor, you know, I've been doing a sermon series in Revelation. And some people say, Pastor, why don't you preach a Revelation more before this, you know? I could, you know, it's funny. With public opinion, you're either doing not enough or you're doing too much. It's a really interesting dynamic to be in, honestly. But the idea is that if you don't know the Old Testament, you're not going to understand the book of Revelation. So my idea is that I want to build over the last 8 years your understanding of Scripture, and then you'll be able to understand Revelation in its appropriate context. We find that the Lord is going to speak to John, and what is he going to speak to him about? He's going to write on the scroll what you see and send it to the seven churches. We find that the text tells us that the message of Revelation is primarily for the seven churches of the ancient world, of Turkey, of Asia Minor. We need to understand that the text is telling us that this message is directed to the seven churches, and what we're going to study next time we're together is those messages. But we need to understand something, that the Lord knows what is going on in the seven churches in the book of Revelation. The Lord knows what is going on in the Lockport Seventh-day Adventist Church. He knows you. He desires to be with you. He desires to have a relationship with you. When you think that Christianity is what you do for God, your priorities are in the wrong place. True Christianity is realizing that God knows you, and he desires to have a relationship with you, to love you and go through life together as you await his soon second return. God is going to speak to John because he desires to communicate with him. He speaks out of love. And this is what the next verse says in Revelation chapter 1, verse 17. When I saw him, I fell at his feet as though dead. Then he placed his right hand on me and said, "Do not be afraid. I am the first and the last." Let's realize the context of this text. John is incarcerated. He's on this island for his faith. And let's be clear on something. Let's have respect for John. Our world today in the United States is not in harmony with everything that Christians believe, okay? We need to understand the difference. There's a difference between a difference of opinion and persecution. I believe that certain Christians are thinking to themselves, everyone's persecuting me because they don't believe exactly how I believe. That's not persecution. Persecution is what John is experiencing by being incarcerated for his faith. He's incarcerated, and now he sees the Lord. He sees him. And what does John do when he sees the Lord? He goes up to the Lord and gives him kisses and hugs. No, the Bible says he fell at his feet. You know, have you ever thought to yourself, I'm a Seventh-day Adventist. I know the Sabbath truth. I know about the state of the dead. I know about Revelation. I'm not that bad. If you were to, you know, if you think to yourself, I'm a little bit better than those Sunday keepers, those people that don't do, if you think to yourself that you are better than someone else, you are foolish. Because the text says here, if John were to be the one that, if anybody were to say something so foolish as to think that they're better than others, it would be John. But instead, we find that John sees the Lord and he falls on his feet. None of us can stand before the Lord and stand up on our two feet thinking to ourselves that we are good enough. Each one of us are in need of Jesus, and each one of us would fall at the feet of him. But that's not it, folks. The text says here that then he placed his right hand on me. And you're going to think to yourself, oh, it's his right hand, not his left hand. Big whoop. No, 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 no. In the biblical understanding, the right hand is a term to use of acceptance. That the Lord goes to John and picks him up, and he's accepting John in his broken state, and he's going to encourage him. This is not the first time this happens. This also happens in Daniel chapter 10. When Daniel sees the Lord, he falls on his face. He's sick to his stomach. This happens to Isaiah. Isaiah says, I can't even speak to the Lord. But the Lord, instead of saying to us, haha, yeah, that's right. You better know that you can't stand before me. He picks him up and he gets him off the floor. He says, do not be afraid. I am the first and the last. You know, if you were to take something from this sermon, there's a lot of things you can possibly take. I want you all to think about this. What do you guys see here? It's a goat. Man, you're a whiz, Bill. You're a whiz. What kind of goat is that? Okay, that's too general. Does anybody know what kind of goat that is? This is what you call, I don't know the Latin term, but this is what you call a fainting goat. If you've ever seen, you can watch on YouTube. I asked my wife, should I show a YouTube little clip? And she's like, I don't think you should. My wife keeps me grounded, I'll tell you that, okay? If you were to Google fainting goats, you will realize these goats have this genetic condition that if you scare them, if you spook them, they're going to freeze and fall over. And you know what's really interesting about these goats is that they never lose consciousness when they faint. Have you ever fainted and you're like, whoa, what happened to me? I blacked out. Well, these goats never lose consciousness. It's just they can't help it. They can't help it. They are going to fall over if you spook them. And that's why there's a ton of YouTube videos highlighting those spooks. The point is, each one of us, no matter if you've been in the church for a long time, No matter if you haven't been baptized, no matter if you have been baptized, it doesn't matter who you are. In the eyes of God, you're simply a fainting goat. That if you were to be in front of the Lord, you will fall over. You would notice your sin condition, and you will fall over. But what does the Lord do? He picks us up with his right hand, and he encourages us. I believe that one of the biggest turnoffs that Christians can do is tell the world that we are better than them. If anything God has done in our lives is because of him working in us, it's not because of us or ourselves, but because God has picked us up, he will lead us forward. I originally asked you, what are you intimidated by? Is it heights? Is it driving? Or is it, you know, whatever the case is, are you intimidated by a blizzard, right? Like, are you intimidated by slush on the ground, and when you're driving, you feel that vibration? And you're like, oh, I don't like that. Each one of us have a common denominator, and that is we would be intimidated by Jesus. But at the same time, we have a common denominator. Like here, we find a portrait of Jesus holding a boy, or if you're a girl, a girl. Our Lord embraces us. Despite his glory, he cares for us, and he desires to be in a relationship with you and with me. And that each one of us should understand that the God of the universe also cares for you on the singular level. And may that be the foundation for your Christian experience. As you walk with the Lord, know that you are next to the God of the universe, the creator of the universe, but also the one that cares about you and will embrace you as you are and will lead you in your life. If you desire to have a relationship with Christ, today is the day. Not tomorrow, it wasn't yesterday, but it's today. And I pray that you accept the Lord in your life, and that you can ask him to lead you and guide you as you await his soon return. Let's pray. Lord, as we think about this idea of being intimidated by something, Lord, we may be intimidated by financial ruin or intimidated by heights, but Lord, we're on the core level, we are intimidated by you, Lord. But at the same time, you don't desire to use that intimidation against us, but you desire to pick us up and to guide us, Lord. And may we be able to invite others that they may not be good enough, but despite where we fall, you pick us up and you desire to lead us and to guide us as we await your soon return. Lord, may you guide this Lockport Seventh-day Adventist Church to be the church that we need to be. We pray this in the name of Jesus.